a missionary came from the Baptist church that my grandfather was very active in and told him that the future of the Baptist church was to address the life of Christ towards the Hispanic community that was growing in Houston. And at that time, there were some descendants from the time of the Texas independence, but the most majority of the people had come because of the Mexican Revolution. So they had migrated to Houston and formed a nice nucleus, of which the Saravia family were one of the big owners of businesses and things. And my father was, so my father as a child started associating with the Mexican community. And that's how he started learning Spanish. And he perfected his skills when he went to Rice, but in truth, his Spanish came from being associating with the people that lived here in Houston from Mexico. There were very few people from other Spanish-speaking countries of the world in that time here in Houston. And so that's why while he was a student at Rice and all, he met Albino Torres, who was a famous orchestra musician, leader, and they formed the Orquesta Típica Mexicana, and my father loved to play the accordion and be the announcer and do the business stuff. He loved announcing. So when he had to leave Rice, he went up, you know, to New York, and that was a different life. But while he was in Houston, he was Mexicano. Punto. He hadn't met my mother or anything. So it was, you know, it was his desire to be amongst his Mexican friends.
What was his full name?
Curtis Leon Farrington.
And his family had been from Texas?
They were. And tell you, there was prejudice inside the family against blacks and against Hispanics, against their Catholics. Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
So it was remarkable that he, you know, he just fell in love with the Mexican community of Houston. And all his best friends were from that community. So the Estrellas, who was a dentist. I mean, I can just go down the line of all the people that were active. Now, when my grandfather, Felipe Santander, came with my mother in 1924 to Houston, he was one of the ones that formed the Club Mexico Bello, Club Recreativo y Cultural Mexico Bello, whose goal was to maintain the Mexican culture amongst the people from Mexico that lived here. So they celebrated Mexican independence in the 5th of May, but not until the 1950s with a police officer, Samaron, who became the president of that group, the leader of the Club Mexico Bello, did we start the quinceañeras celebration for them. But meanwhile, they had elegant parties. And Oscar Holcomb was the mayor of Houston.
Mm-hmm.
And when they would have a party, the people that lived around wherever that party was being held, and it was usually the ladies all dressed in beautiful long gowns, and the men wore tux. Well, the people complained that it was noisy, so they invited Oscar Holcomb to the parties. And he got up at city council and told them it was not noisy, and it was elegant, and they were just jealous.
I love it.
And so that's how the Club Mexico Bello became more acceptable to Houston society as a whole because of Oscar Holcomb's being involved with the Club Mexico Bello. And that was one of the first clubs here because we didn't have LULAC and we didn't have, you know, others. Now, late 60s and early 70s, we had a lot of small clubs that formed and were very active in celebrating in their homes the Mexican cultures. And that was like Familias Unidas and Club Verde Mar. And there was a bunch of them.
And were they groups based of people from Mexico now here? Or were they
descendants
kind of
descendants of those groups? They by that time, they were descendants mostly of those groups, not the ones that had come over.
But that was the organizing system,
yes.
Kind of
yes.
Organic to the community.
Yes.
And dissemination of culture. So
yes, that's what it was. They would do folkloric dancing, and they would do things, you know, that would keep the culture alive.
But no fun. But you weren't getting grants from anyone. It was all
cooperando absolutely.
Con
and
community culture capital.
And most of the things done in the homes. You know, most of the celebrations done in the homes.
Mm.
Sembradores de Amistad came in at that time. That was an organization already formed in Mexico that was benevolent, that, you know, helped other people. And they formed a nice big group here. I mean, this was in the 60s, 70s, and 80s.
Mm.
But most of those groups just, in fact, by the 70s, we see the immigration of more people coming in from South America. And they're mostly professional people, like doctors and lawyers, because of the turmoil in those countries. And so then we see another groups being formed, such as the what they call the Club 11, which was a group of from Chile, from Colombia, from Mexico.
I had not heard of that. Tell me more about Club 11.
Club 11.
¿Cómo le decían en español?
El Club 11.
El Club 11.
Yeah, and they were 11 couples that would, each one would have a party with a theme, with a cultural theme at their house once a month. You know, each family had one party a year. And then at Christmas time, they would all get together and have a ball or a gala that they didn't raise money, they just paid for the cost from their pockets and invited their friends at the doctor's club. Because many of those members were doctors.